Today it is our great fortune that we are observing the Tirubhaktiti Mahotsav of Srila Rupa Goswami, the disappearance day of Srila Rupa Goswami. Does anyone need translation? Oh, you are doing it. Any questions? Siddhartha Nastakura says, Gaurangya sanikane nitta siddha karimane seja brajanda sutupa. One can easily go to the lotus feet of Brajanda Gandhan Shri Krishna. How? Gaurangya sanikane nitta siddha karimane. If you hold within your heart the conception, the reality that the associates of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, they are not ordinary human beings, but they are Nitya Siddha. They are eternally perfect associates of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and Radha Krishna, who, when Mahaprabhu descends to this world, they descend with him, along with him. So unprecedented among those associates of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is Srila Rupa Goswami. Why? Because Srimati Radharani, she is not herself personally explained what is her beautiful pastimes and how to attain them. Lalita and Vishakha, they have not explained. Even they came in this world as sort of Damda and Rai Ramananda. They didn't tell. They kept these secrets inside. They shared with each other. So Radha Krishna and their associates in their Leela, and also when they come in Gaura Leela, all are very secretive. Only Srila Rupa Goswami became Vacha. Vacha means talkative. And he spoke very secret things that others would not tell. But he was empowered to do so by Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu himself. Therefore it is said, Vrindavaniyam rasakali vartam kalina luktam nija shakti utka sanchari rupai ratanur punasa Prabhurvido Pragivaloka Shishti. Just as at the beginning of the creation of the universe, the Supreme Lord imparted the knowledge of how to create the world into the heart of Lord Brahma. So similarly, at a time in this world when after Krishna's pastimes had disappeared and the discussion of his rasakeli, beautiful loving pastimes had disappeared from the world, at that time Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu inspired the heart of Srila Rupa Goswami to manifest the world of rasa. So Rupa Goswami himself has written in the second verse of Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu, Vidhi yasya prayanaha pravatitoham paraka rupo api tasya harer padakamalam bande chaitanya devasya. I am praying to the lotus feet of Sri Krishna, who has appeared as Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Baraka Rupopi, although this Rupa is Baraka, very insignificant and useless, but that Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, Hridiyasa Prairanaha, he has inspired this katha in my heart, and in this way I am manifesting Sri Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu. So Srila Kavikana Pola said, Priya Swarupe, Daita Swarupe, Prema Swarupe, Sahajavi Rupe, Nijana Rupe, Swabila Swarupe, Ntatana Rupe, Prabhureka Rupe. He said, Rupa Goswami is Priya Swarupe, very dear to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, or very dear to Swarup Damodar, Mahaprabhu's intimate associate Lalita. Lalita is the supermost among all the Sakhis of Radhika. And the leader of Lalita's maid servants is Rupa Manjari. And that Rupa Manjari comes in his world as Srila Rupa Goswami. And therefore, all the Gaudiyas to this day, they are proud to say we aspire to be Rupanuga. Oh, Rupanuga, the followers of Rupa Goswami. Following Rupa Goswami outwardly, in the way he practiced sadhana, and following Rupa Manji inwardly. Seva Paripati, methods of service to Radhika. So Priya Sarupe, Daita Sarupe, he's Daita Sarup, that means Dat Atmanam, who has given his soul completely to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Prema Sarupe, Rupa Goswami is the made of love in separation from head to toe. The body of Rupa Goswami is not like us, made of skin and blood. Rupa Goswami is a divine transcendental being, made of pure love for the divine couple and Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Prema Sarupe, Sahaja Virupe. His love is Sahaj, natural. Nija Anurupe, Praporeka Rupe. Nija Anurupe means whatever his dear Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was feeling, it was reflected into his heart. In that sense, Praporeka Rupe, he's non different from Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Tat Anurupe, he's pervaded from head to toe in the mercy of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Swavilasa Rupe. In fact, Rupa Goswami is one vilas, one pastime of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu himself. None different from him. Ananda Chinmaya Rasa Pratipavitavis Tarbeya Eva Nija Rupa Taya Kalavi. Like this. Rupa Goswami is one, like, as the gopis are Kaya Vyuha Rupa, Kaya Vyuha Rupa. Bodily manifestations of Radhika. So Rupa Goswami is the bodily manifestation of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. In India, the poet Kalidas, he was renowned as the greatest poet of all time. In Sanskrit. Kalidas. Oh, until Rupa Goswami wrote his poetry. There is no comparison to the poetry of Srila Rupa Goswami. In his poetry, he has explained bhakti from the very beginning stages. What is the sadhu of faith? And how this faith develops into sadhu sangha, association of saints, bhajana kriya, engaging in the different limbs of bhakti yoga, and in this way, gradually, anatta nivritti, all unwanted desires, attachments, darkness, misconceptions, and weakness of heart, and offenses. They slowly become cleared, and then nishta comes, steadiness. And after steadiness, nishta hoye upajoye prema rataranga. Once, if a devotee can come to the stage of steadiness, that means the sustained intensity of endeavor. That your intensity of endeavor to attain Krishna is sustained at every moment. Then from this, actually, until this point, bhakti is there, but you have no subjective conscious experience of bhakti in its true form. But after nishtha, then you become subjectively aware of the uncovered and pure nature of devotion, and that is called ruchi. A taste in name, a taste in Krishna's form, a taste in Krishna's qualities, a taste in serving the deity, in kirtan, in harikatha, in parakrama, all the activities become very relishable. When this taste becomes more intense, it becomes asakti, attachment. And in the stage of attachment, the heart is so. Tadara jastamo bhava kamalabhajaste cheta eta anavidam stitam sattve prasidati. This is asakti. The heart is almost completely sattvic. And in that shining heart, the reflection of your own swarup, antastinti abhishta tat seva upayogi dehena, appears there. And so then the devotee is very touched. Because he realized, I Nanda Tulu Jakinkaram Krishna, I am your maidservant. And then he does very intense sadhana bhajan, more than before even. That his abhiman, self-conception, will be situated forever in that spiritual body and serving in Raghu Krishna's lila. Srila Rupa Goswami has very beautifully described all of these things. So he describes sadhana bhakti, then bhava bhakti. When the pure spiritual energy appears in our heart, Shuddha Sattva Visheshastva, Svema Suryam Susami Bhagavijibis Chitana Sanya, the chitta melts completely. And one is overwhelmed with desires. Oh, where is my Ishtadev? How can I render some favorable service to Radha and Krishna? And how can I have Surya Bhav? That means a very intimate friendship with Radha and Krishna. Very private and personal relationship with them. All these feelings come. And when Bhav becomes more intense, it turns into prayer. Samyan Masrinita Svanto Mamatati Shyamkita. When Bhav becomes infused with an excessive amount of Mamata. Oh Sham Sundar. Oh Gandharvika, you are mine. Then it's called praying. In that stage, avidya takila shesha. There is no awareness at all of any kind of klesh. No avidya, asmit, rag, dvesha, vinivesh. All the kleshas, the causes of misery. Though one may be here in this world, but one is totally oblivious to anything. Vaishnavere jyoti dekare vyabhahare duk nishtaya janise parananda suk. Srila Bhaktivedanta Thakur said, if you see a pure Vaishnava and it looks like they are suffering, don't think so. You should know that they are experiencing paramananda, supreme joy. That is in the stage of praying. Rupa Goswami described all this. But what comes after praying? He has described the stages of praying. Praying, snaya, man, pranaya, rag, anurag, bhav, mahabhav, ruddhabhav, adiruddhabhav, mohanakya mahabhav, mohanakya mahabhav, madanakya mahabhav. All these stages of love. Any ordinary person cannot imagine. And each stage has so many varieties also. And he has given examples to illustrate them as well. So if Rupa Goswami was not empowered by Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, then no one would have known what Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was realizing in his pastimes. He is Krishna, realizing the highest prema of Radharani. But what is that? No one would have known. And therefore Narottama Das Thakur said, Sri Chaitanya Mano Vishtam Stapitam yena bhutale svayam rupakadha bhajyam tadati svapadantikam. When will Rupa Goswami give me the shelter of his lotus feet? He is the one person who realized the innermost desires of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and then manifested them in this world. Adadanasthinam dante Hiram jache puna puna Srimad Rupa Padam Godra Tulisham Janma Janma. So I am begging, taking straw between my teeth and falling on the ground again and again and weeping. Oh Rupa Goswami, let me be the dust of your lotus feet lifetime after lifetime. What is it that causes the devotee to become so maddened, to become so desperate, to dedicate everything to the service of Srila Rupa Goswami? Srila Narottama Das Thakur has prayed here. Your lotus feet are my japa, they are my mantra, they are my brat, my vows, they are my dharma, they are my karma. They are my jivan, they are my treasure, my life, my everything. But without seeing your lotus feet, I feel as if I am burning in deadly poison of a snake, of separation. Chira dine topita jivan. And for many days I have been in this suffering condition. Aha, Prabhu Korida, Rupa Goswami, please be merciful to me. What is it that drives the devotee to become so dedicated and so much hankering for the shelter of Rupa Goswami? Srila Narayana Thakur never even met him. Huh? Why? Because he has heard from Vaishnavas the teachings and the poetry of Srila Rupa Goswami. So our celebration of his disappearance day festival will be successful if hearing the poetry of Rupa Goswami and Lubdha, we become completely infatuated, completely greedy, obsessed and consumed with the desire to meet with Srila Rupa Goswami, then our observance of his disappearance day festival can be called successful. So I want to give some examples from his poetry today. In his, he has written two dramas. Actually he has written others, but the two are prominent. It was originally composed as one drama. But Satyabhama Devi came to Rupa Goswami in a dream and said, write a separate drama about me. And later Chaitanya Mahaprabhu told Rupa Goswami when he arrived in Puri, Krishna yo yadu samutto na puna sustata para brindabhanam prajatya sa kachin naiva gacchati. Hey Rupa, don't take Krishna out of Vrindavan. So then Rupa Goswami saw, oh, though I did not say anything to him, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, knowing my heart, has confirmed what Satyabhama Devi told me in a dream. That my drama, which is the first one in Vrindavan and the second one, mainly based in Dwarka, I should separate them into two. So the one original drama became Vidakta Madhav, then Lalit Madhav. Vidakta Madhav, in the most touching way, in the most moving and tender way, Rupa Goswami has revealed the love of Radha and Krishna when they are very young and how they come to fall in love with each other, even against their will. Because Radhika, she's from a very royal family and her marriage was arranged and she was married to Abhimanyu. And living with her mother-in-law Jutila, sister-in-law Kutila. And Krishna is unmarried. But their great love brings them together and even both resist. But finally they cannot. So Srila Rupa Goswami writes how one day, Radharani, she was feeling such uncontrollable attraction to Krishna. Though she did not met with him directly, or conversed with him, or even looked directly in his eyes. But this love is called the by swabhav. It awakens of its own nature. So she was thinking, what can I do? I should write a letter to him. So she wrote a love letter, but it was not signed. Only some poem. She wrote on a lotus petal. And she folded it up and gave to Lalita and Vishakha. And she's dependent on her friends to deliver this letter to finally reveal her feelings to Krishna and see how he will respond. So in the meantime, Krishna was sitting alone in the forest and he saw a golden champak vine with beautiful golden flowers similar to the complexion of Radharani. And he began to remember her. So at that time, Madhu Mangal came there with a necklace of gunjas, gunja berries. And he came and he was thinking, why is my friend looking so sad? Perhaps it's that upon the canvas of his heart, he has painted the picture of the daughter of Vrishabhanu Maharaj. He was just thinking like this. So he came up to Krishna and put the gunja necklace around his neck. And Krishna said to the Jamrakbhai, oh, when will she, like a restless streak of lightning, be situated on the dark cloud of my chest? So Krishna was talking to himself, even though Madhu Mangal was there and he had given the garland. Madhu Mangal went, hello, Krishna, I am here. Why are you ignoring me? Why are you ignoring me? Krishna said, oh, excuse me, I was just absorbed in the beauty of this vine. Krishna was hiding his feelings. Madhu Mangal wanted to bring them out. He said, and what exactly about this vine is it that's fascinating you? Krishna said, it's very twisty. I can't see where it ends. Again, Krishna's trying to hide his feelings. Madhu Mangal said, give up this crookedness. Why are you trying to cheat me? I know why. Because love is awaiting in your heart. That is why your heart is completely now vacant. That means you have no attention anywhere. He said, why is your heart vacant? Krishna said, here, heart is heart and chest is a synonym, means same thing. Oh, my chest is vacant because I'm not wearing a flower garland. He said, malam bina, I'm without a garland. Madhu Mangal went, balam bina, means no, you're out without a girlfriend. Your problem is not malam bina, it is balam bina. Krishna said, why are you making such unjust accusations against me? Madhu Mangal said, Krishna, you didn't even notice your peacock feather was fallen on the ground. Your pitambara has fallen on the ground. I can see what's going on. All of this is because the bumblebees of your eyes are chasing after the lotus flower of some beautiful maiden. Krishna said, actually you're right, it's true. It's true. Madhu Mangal said, there are many beautiful gopis in Vrindavan. What is so special about this Radha? Krishna said, she just has an indescribable sweetness that cannot be found anywhere else. So just then, as Krishna was opening his heart to Madhu Mangal, Lalita and Vishakha came through the forest bearing the lotus petal with a love letter from Radhika. So Lalita came first and Krishna says, oh Sakhi, what are you doing here? Did you come to, you must have come to pick some flower petals. Means adatum means to pick petals. She said, not adatum, datum. I have not come to pick the petals, I've come to give you a petal. And she presented the rolled up petal to Krishna. So then Krishna took the petal, but he's, you know, he's like the leader. So he's not going to open it and read it himself. He just passes it over to Madhu Mangal. Read this. So then Madhu Mangal, he took the petal. So in Vedic culture, a learned person, before they speak or before they read anything, first they give pranams to their, to whom I have given them mercy. So Madhu Madhu Vichutu Petal. Although the generosity of the Gop caste is well known, still, because the wives of the Vedic Brahmanas, they fed me so sumptuously, first of all, I offer my pranam to the Brahmanas. So then Madam Michael, he opened the leaf, the petal, said, what's this? It's just some letters on it. There are no candies inside. What's the use of this? I thought maybe some sweets were wrapped up inside. It's just some letters. Krishna said, oh, I think that these letters will be nectar for our ears. Please read it. Read it at once. Madhu Mangal, he began to read. Oh, my dear darlings, the beauty of your form is so deeply impressed within my heart that wherever I look, I see that you are there. And I cannot escape, because in any direction that I go, you are there blocking my path. Krishna said, this message is very difficult to understand. Please read it again. Again, you want to relish with his ears. In his heart, he was thinking, Krishna, calm down, don't get too excited. Now, the tree of your desires is about to bear fruit. And he was so happy because he realized it's a letter from Radharani, and the girl for whom he has developed love, she also loves him. Even though it's forbidden in society. So Krishna told himself, calm down, calm down. Read it again. So then he heard it again, and Krishna tried to control himself. And then he said, what is this? I am a coward boy. I wander here and there in the forest with the cows and with my friends, very carefully avoiding talking of any subject matter connected with women. So we will not allow you foul-mouthed girls to come here and pollute us. So you should leave at once. And anyway, I will go back to the village and I will tell the elders what you're up to. And then Krishna began strutting around as if he was very insulted. Madhu Mangal said, oh, Brahmachari Shiromani! You are right. You should give some reply to them. Cut their words with your own sharp arguments. And I will go and tell Brajeshwari, the queen of Gokul, Madhya Yashoda as well. I'll tell your mother about them. So then Lalita and Vishakha looked at each other. What is this? How is this going on? So then Lalita, or Vishakha, she gave Krishna one garland. And she took his garland with her. As she put it on, she took his. Lalita said, oh, alas. We should go at once and try to save Radhika because she's fallen in love with the most unsuitable person. She said, today we have seen the unmovable and unbreakable brahmacharya celibacy of that person who is like an ocean unto which the rivers of so many gopis are flowing. Because Krishna actually at this point, though he had not met with Radhika, he was doing pastimes with many beautiful gopis of Braj. So they criticized him, and then quickly Lalita and Vishakha went away. So Lalita and Vishakha went away, Then Krishna thought to himself, oh, what have I done? I should not have been so cruel. Because now they'll tell Radhika, and perhaps you're just about able to hold her patience for a few days, and then she may turn against me. And she won't love me anymore. So I have spoiled my own chances. What should I do? Oh, Madhu Mangal, I think the only way to solve this problem is I should write a love letter and send it to her. Madhu Mangal said, a love letter, send it like roses, will be the perfect solution to this problem. So let's go to Prashkan Tirtha. Prashkan Tirtha is on the bank of Jamuna, beneath the hill Dwadashaditya Tila, very close to Kaliyavad. And it is a forest of beautiful red roses. Even today, if you go there, there are forests of beautiful red roses. So then, Lalita and Vishakha arrived and they told Radharani what happened. Radharani began to cry. She didn't say anything to her friends, but in her heart she thought, I should just kill myself now. Because I have transgressed all dharma. And on the other hand, I cannot give him up. So how can I stay alive? So she told Lalita, oh Lalita, please go and inform Jutila that I have gone to the Dwadashaditya Tila. Aditya means the sun god. So it's well known that Radhika worships the sun god at Suryakund. But she also worships the sun god at Dwadashaditya Tila. It's the hill upon which now the temple of Madan Mohan is situated. And just as you worship Vishnu with Tulsi, or Shiva with bear leaves, or Durga with hibiscus flowers, so Surya Devi is worshipped with red roses. And that's why there are big forests of red roses there, especially growing for the pleasure to be offered to Aditya, the sun god, at Dwadashaditya Tila. So Lalita went to tell Jutila, and Radhika and Vishakha, they set off and they walked in the direction of Dwadashaditya Tila. As they were approaching, Radharani said, hey, what is this? The sun is setting in the east, untimely. The sun sets in the west. How is it setting in the east? In the middle of the day. How is it possible? So when the sun is setting, all the sky becomes full of a red glow. So Vishakha said, this is not the sun setting, this is the glow of the forest of roses of Dwadashaditya Tila. So they walked into that forest and they came on the bank of Jamuna. But what happened? Krishna and Madhu Mangal had gone there and Krishna told Madhu Mangal, pick the rose leaves and we'll squeeze them, and squeezing out the red juice will make a red ink, and with this we'll write a love letter to Radhika in the juice of red rose petals. So just as they were preparing the ink for the letter, Krishna said, hey Madhu Mangal, this is not the valley of Mount Sumeru. Sumeru is a mountain of gold. He said, this is not the valley of Mount Sumeru, but why is everywhere becoming filled with a golden effulgence? And why can I hear the astonishing vibration? Anika mantra nada manjunu purara paskala samaja raja hamsa vamsanikvanati gora. The sound of ankle bells so sweet, like the warbling of Raja Hamsa swans. Then he looked, oh, two girls are coming. Quickly hide. So Krishna and Madhu Mangal, they hid in the bushes and they watched. Two girls were approaching. Radhika and Vishakha. As they were approaching, Radharani said, O Sakhi, when you talk, remember me. Because she was thinking, now she will leave. Remember me. And for every time I have visited this place, pick One rose. Then Vishakha, she began to cry. She said, "Oh Radhika, how can you speak like this? You have so much patience, so much gravity. Your mind is so steady. How come you've become so upset?" Radharani said, "You say that I have so many virtues, but the son of Nanda Maharaj has stolen all my virtues. By the large dam of his chest, he has blocked the river of my patience." "Oh, by the yup of his arms." Yup means in a sacrifice. If there's a sacrifice, animal sacrifice, then the animal who will be sacrificed is tied to a pillar called a yup. Radharani said, "The two arms of Krishna are the yup to which was tied the sacrificial animal of my chastity." So in this way, my patience, my chastity, his smile is like the light of the moon which withers away the daytime lotus of my Kula Dharma, my dedication to the righteousness and religion that is followed by all my forefathers. In fact, Krishna, he has stolen away all my qualities. Krishna was hiding with Madananga. He said, "Oh Radhika, and you have stolen away all my qualities too. Your sweetness has stolen all my qualities." You see, Radhika is from a very religious dharmic family. And Krishna has said, "My mother is the crushed jewel of all chaste ladies and my father is the senior in the assembly of sadhus. So how is it that these dharmic feelings have come in my heart? How is it possible?" So Radhika said, "Oh, Krishna has stolen all my qualities." And Krishna was watching, "Oh Radhika, your sweetness has stolen all my qualities." So then Radharani, she took off her necklace and she gave her necklace to Vishakha. Then Vishakha began to cry even more. Why? Because when a person is about to die, they distribute their favorite articles to their loved ones. So she knew she was preparing to die by giving the necklace. So then Radharani said, "Akarunya Krishna yadi maitavaga katavidam mudamarodi meikuru pramimam uttarakritim tamalasya skande vinhita buja vallare riyam yathabrindarande chirat avichalatistatitanu." "Oh Vishakha, if Krishna will not be merciful to me, then you should not cry because it's not any fault of yours. But I request you just one thing. Can you do my uttarakriti?" That means my funeral ceremony. "How should you perform my funeral ceremony? You should take the arms of my dead body and wrap them around the tamal tree here on the bank of Jamuna, so my body can stay here in Vrindavan forever, as if holding on to Krishna. This is the best I can do." Krishna was looking, he said, "Madhumanga, listen to what she said. She has such love." Radharani said, she was preparing to die. She came on the bank of Jamuna. She said, "I will never again see the beautiful face of Krishna. Oh Vishakha, give me a picture of Krishna. Let me look at him just one last time." So previously, Radhika, Vishakha made a picture, but she didn't have the picture with her. She said, I don't have the picture with me. I have nothing to draw a picture with me now. Radhika said, all right. Then I will look at him in my meditation. And she sat down. She began to meditate. She said, oh Krishna, is it right that you should steal my heart with your smiles and glances and then just neglect me? Krishna from his hiding place, he softly spoke. Oh, can a person who is dying neglect the only medicine that can keep him alive? And at once Krishna came out from the bushes. And he came and he stood in front of Radhika. Vishakha became excited. Oh Radhika, Radhika, your meditation is successful. When Dhruva Maharaj was meditating, then he opened his eyes and his meditation, what was inside, the man was standing in front of him. This is the success of meditation. Oh Radhika, open your eyes. Your meditation is successful. Radhika, open your eyes. And so, Krishna. Oh, what a beautiful dream. Vishakha said, you're dreaming while you're awake. This is not a dream. Madhumanga was there. He was trying to, because Krishna was stunned seeing the beauty of Radhika, and Radhika didn't even know whether it was real or not. So the two are face to face, but no pastime, nothing is happening. So that's why Sakas and Sakis are there. Madhumanga, he said, oh, look, she's stolen your garland. You should take it back. Because Vishakha bought, when she gave Krishna garland, she stole his, bought it and gave it to Radhika. So the garland is falling over the chest. So Madhumanga was trying to get Radhika to touch, Krishna to touch Radhika somehow. So Madhumanga said, she stole your garland, take it back. Krishna said, even in my dreams, I have never touched a girl so beautiful. And he could not move. So just then, at that moment, they heard a voice. Oh, granddaughter, Vishakha! Vishakha is like the granddaughter of the Jatila, insane family. What are you doing here with my daughter? Why haven't you collected the incense and all the paraphernalia for puja of the sun god? And what is this rake doing here? This notorious boy? Jatila came up to Krishna and said, don't look at my daughter-in-law with your crooked eyes. Madhumanga said, my friend never has squinty eyes like you. His eyes always look with compassion. It's your eyes that are squinting all the time. You should give a benediction to your own eyes, Mahanga and Babatu, that they should not squint anymore. Krishna said, what's the problem? Jatila said, oh, everyone knows about you. You are attracting all the girls in Vrindavan and only my daughter-in-law has remained untouched. She is a very sweet and innocent girl and you are a very restless and handsome boy and now you are meeting together in the forest. This is not an acceptable situation. You should leave here at once. Krishna said, I'll go when I want to go. So then, and Jatila, she took the hand of Radharani, seeing that Krishna would not leave, and took Radharani away. And Krishna was left. The meeting was almost successful. At least now, both know that they love each other. It's a progress from before. Because Krishna did not know whether Radhika loved him, and Radhika did not know whether Krishna loved her. But now they know. Now the only thing remains to somehow escape from the watchful eyes of society and meet someone. So in this way, in the most beautiful poetry, Srila Rupa Goswami has manifested the astonishing rasa of Krishna's lila in this world. Someone is very fortunate if a drop of this nectar will actually go in their ear. Not that this is a fiction, or a story, or a legend, or anything from the fanciful imagination of a poet. But what is this? This is a Paramatattva, the supreme truth, the ultimate reality. God Himself, in His highest realm, is performing such pastimes. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu came into this world to invite us to participate in that lila. And it was Rupa Goswami whom He empowered to show the path. Everything that Srila Rupa Goswami writes is 100% true and perfect. Once upon a time, he was writing a poem, and his elder brother and guru, Srila Sanatana Goswami, came. "Oh Rupa, what are you writing? Can I see?" "Yes, of course." Yeah. So then, Sanatana Goswami, "Navagoro chanagorim pravarindi varambaram manistavaka vidyoti venivyalanganapanam." "Oh Radhika, your complexion is like fresh golden garochana. Your cloth is like a blue lotus flower. And the braid of your hair, which is long and black and decorated upon the top by some jewels, appears to be the hood of a deadly serpent." Srila Sanatana Goswami read it. Said, "Oh Rupa, our Swamini Radhika is full of nectar. And a snake is full of poison. So why have you described the braid of Radhika with the jewels on the top to be like a snake, poisonous snake?" Rupa was very humble. He said, "Oh, perhaps you can correct it and you can adjust this line of the poem. Veni valanganapanam." Sanatana Goswami said, "Yes." And then he thought, but no idea came to him. Which is surprising, because Srila Sanatana Goswami is the most astonishing poet. In a moment he can compose beautiful poetry, but he had a writer's block. At that moment, he couldn't think of something. So then he told Rupa, "Alright, I'll think about it and I'll tell you later." So then Sanatana Goswami went away and he was doing parikrama of Giriraj Govardhan. Every day he used to do parikrama of Govardhan. And when he arrived at Radhakund, there he saw some young girls who were playing. And there was a swing. And one girl was sitting on the swing, and the other girls were singing and pushing her. And then he looked and he saw that behind the girl was a dangerous black snake. And he ran there. "Oh Lali, Lali, be careful, be careful." And as he approached, all the girls disappeared. The jeweler, the swing disappeared. There was nothing there. And then he realized, oh, it was Radhika and her sakis. And it was not a snake. It was her braid. But it was exactly like a snake. The movements of a snake, very beautiful with a jewel on the top. And when Krishna sees it, it's as if his heart has been bitten and he cannot live. So then Sanatana Goswami went back to Srila Rupa Goswami. And he said, Rupa Goswami asked him, "Oh, have you thought of how to change this poetry?" Srila Sankara Swami said, "Oh Rupa, anything that you write is fine by me." Therefore, perform this pastime to impress upon us that every word of Rupa Goswami is a manifestation of the divine reality. And in this mood, we take shelter of Srila Rupa Goswami. So that poem, that Srila Sanatana Goswami wanted to correct, that's the first verse of a poem called Sri Chatu Pushpanjali. So we want to complete our Shraddha Pushpanjali to Rupa Goswami with the discussion of Chatu Pushpanjali of Rupa Goswami. Just as you can only worship the Ganges with water from the Ganges, I can only give my Pushpanjali with Rupa Goswami's Pushpanjali. So Srila Rupa Goswami has prayed. Nava Koro Chana Kauri Pravarindi Varambara Manistavaka Vidyoti Veni Vyalangana Panam. O Brindavanishri, I offer prayers to you. This is called Chatu Pushpanjali. Pushpanjali means an offering of flowers in the form of chatu. Chatu means words of flattery. If you want to get someone's favor, then you speak to them very sweetly about their own glories. And by this flattery, then they may become happy and fulfill your desires. So in this poem, Srila Rupa Goswami is showing us the Bhajan Chaturya, the cunningness, the cleverness. Many persons, they chant Harinam and try to do Smaran for years and years and years with very little or no result even. Why? Because they're lacking in the Chaturya, the cleverness, the skill, the expertise in how to go deeply into the Dhruva Anusmriti, fixed and continuous remembrance of Krishna's Leela. You should know that chanting Harinam and trying to remember Krishna's Leela is not sadhana, to go through anatta nivritti. In fact, it may cause anatta pravritti, more anattas. First one should hear the name of Krishna, hear and chant about his form, qualities, and pastimes one can hear and chant will purify the heart. But to artificially do smaran, this is not the teaching of our Goswamis. When the heart is purified, Krishna's name, then form, qualities, and pastimes, they awaken by themselves, naturally. So, here Rupa Goswami is saying, he's showing the Bhajan Chaturya. Oh, your golden complexion is like fresh karocha. Your cloth is like a blue lotus. And your braid, studded with jewels on the top, is like the hood of a black serpent. Upambana gatamana prahari mukamandalam Navendu nindu balodhyat kasturi tilaka. Though I have used upama, upama means comparisons, to say what your complexion is like, what your cloth is like, what your braid is like. But upama nagata manim, your face defies all comparison. I cannot compare your face with anything. It is so extraordinarily beautiful. More beautiful than the moon, more beautiful than a lotus flower, or any other possible object of comparison. And upon your forehead, there's a very beautiful tilak, like the new moon, painted in kasturi. So here, Srila Rupa Goswami is doing the Rupa Dhyana. He's not describing any lila. Only he's meditating on Radhika's group of form, step by step. Bhujitananga kodandam lola nila kalavalin kajal ucchvalita rajats chakori charu lochanam. O Radhika, the curvature of your eyebrows puts to shame the bow of Cupid. Your swaying tresses of black curling hair are splendid, and your eyes, which are wonderfully decorated with black kajal, look like a pair of youthful chakori birds, which are enamored by the moon. Tila pushpa pranasakra virajat paramoptikam adaruddhut bandukam kundali bandurajam. There's a splendid pearl decorating the tip of your nose, which is like a sesame flower. And your lips are deep red like banduka flowers. And when you smile, your rows of teeth are glittering like white jasmine buds. So this is the first one should meditate on Roop, then Gun, then associates and so on. So these are the qualities of Radhika. Rupa Goswami has described in Ujjwala Nila Mani 25 qualities of Radhika. Madhurjayam naya vaya chapala bhanga ujjwala smitam. Here your smile is so shining. Ujjwala smita, your smile is shining. Your eyes are restless. So here we see that in poetry, Rupa Goswami is meditating, going through the beauty of Radhika's form and her qualities. Saratna swarna rajiva kanika krita kanika kasturi bindu chibukam ratna kredekalu ujjwalam. The central karnikara, that means the seed pod of lotus flower with jewels stuck in it, has been used as decorations upon your ears. And your chin has a dot of musk. And you're wearing a necklace full of jewels. Divyangada parishpanga lasad bhuja mrinalika valani ratna valaya kalalambi kalavikam. Your beautiful arms, which are cool and long and slender like the stems of a lotus, are adorned with armlets, and upon your wrists there are bracelets composed of blue sapphires that jingle sweetly as your arms move. Ratnanguri akolasi varanguli karambuja manohara mahara vihari kuchakutmalam. Each of the fingers of your lotus hands are decorated with rings. Actually, every finger on the left hand of Radhika is decorated with rings. And on the right hand, only these three. And your breasts are adorned with an enchanting precious necklace. Romali bhuja ki murda ratna patar lanchitam valita yalata badha kshinapangur matamam. O Radhika, there is a very fine line of dark hair which rises above your navel, like a snake, and you're wearing a necklace, and so the jewel of that necklace appears to be the jewel on the head of your Romavali, fine line of hairs above your navel. Your very slender waist is bent slightly by the weight of your breast, and your stomach is marked, there were three lines. So these are considered to be the signs of extreme beauty. Srila Rupa Goswami has also written about Radhika's Ramavali. He said once, Lalita criticized Krishna. You are a thief because by your glance you stole the hearts of all the gopis of Vrindavan. Krishna said, no, I am never a thief. Vishakha Sakhi said, yes, yes, we know that Kadamba tree at Bhadrakali Tirtha is the witness of your innocence. Bhadrakali Tirtha, Bhadrakali means Katyani. So when the gopis were worshipping Katyani, Krishna climbed on Kadamba tree and stole all their clothes. So she's saying, oh yes, that Kadamba tree at Bhadrakali Tirtha is witness that you are never a thief. Krishna said, no, no, I am saintly. I always tell the truth. You should devise some plan, some test by which my innocence can be proven. Lalita Sakhi said, yes, you should do trial by ordeal. Trial by ordeal. You know, sometimes they have, in ancient times, they used to do a trial by ordeal. Say something like, okay, we'll put you in a fire and if you don't burn, then you're innocent. Trial by ordeal. Oh, we have placed a poisonous snake in this clay pot. If you put your hand inside and you're not bitten, then we'll say you're innocent. This is called trial by ordeal to prove one's innocence. So she said, yes, we will have a trial by ordeal. So Lalita said, yes, you should put your hand on the jewel on the head of the serpent of Radhika's Ramavali. Understand? Krishna said, what? This is a very dangerous test. Radhika Sakhi, what are you talking about? You are Bhujanga Acharya. The Bhujanga Acharya. That means the Acharya of Bhujanga. Bhu means the earth. So Bhujanga, whose body moves among the earth, is called a snake. So you are Bhujanga Acharya. Why? Because Agasura was a big snake. And you defeated him. Kaliya serpent was a big snake and you defeated him. And when your father Nanda Maharaj was being swallowed by a snake at Ambikavan, at that time you released that snake and he became a devata. So you are Bhujanga Acharya. Why should you be afraid of this test? So the word Bhujanga also has another meaning. It means paramour. Once beloved, outside of Dharma. Once illicit love is also called Bhujanga. So she said, oh, you are Bhujanga Acharya. Don't be afraid. When Radhika heard Sakhi is daring Krishna to touch her, Radhika said, that's enough. First you bring me here to the forest and now you're trying to shame me. I'm leaving. And she went from there. So these are all the features of Radhika's Rup. Rupa Saundarya, the beauty of Radhika that enchants Krishna. Mani Vistara Sanadara Bisvara Soni Rodasa Hema Ramba Madaramba Stambano Rupyuga Kritim. Around your broad hips is a splendid tinkling and jewel-studded waistband with bells. And your shapely thighs crush the pride of the golden trunk of a plantain tree. Janu dyuti jitakshula pitaratna samudakam sarani raja niraja manjira barana padam. The splendor of your beautiful knees puts to shame the radiance of round yellow sapphire jewelry cases. Sapphires are not only blue, there are yellow sapphires also. And your beautiful feet, which are adorned with tinkling ankle bells, gleam. And your soles of your feet are like red lotuses that blossom in the autumn season. Rakindu koti saundarya jaicha padana kajutim astabi satrika bhavar Akuli Kritavikraham. The radiant brilliance of the nails of your lotus feet defeats the brilliance of the beauty of millions of full moons, and your entire form is pervaded by 8 sattvic bhavs, such as perspiration and becoming stunned. Mukundangi kritapangam anangurmitarangitam tamaraptasyanandam vande brindavaneshwari. As you flash your sidelong glances at Krishna, you swell with waves of amorous desire, and when you meet with him, you experience infinite bliss. O Brindavaneshwari, I worship you, the reservoir of all divine qualities. So the restless eyes of Radhika, this is one of Chalapapangi. It is one of the 25 qualities of Radhika, restless eyes. Ai pradyan mahabhava madhuri vivalantare ashesha nayaka vasta prakritya bhuta chestite. O Radhika, your heart is inundated by the combined sweetness of all the symptoms of Mahabhav arising simultaneously in you. Because you possess the attributes of unlimited Nayikas. In the classical Rasa Shastra, it is said that Nayikas or heroines are of so many different types. They are Dhira, very sober, or Adhira, impetuous, or Dhira-Dhira, mixtures of both. They are Mugdha, innocent and gullible, or Pragalabha, very bold, experienced and aggressive, or Madhya, mixtures of both. They are Mridhi, soft, or Prakara, very harsh, or Sama, in the middle. They are Abhisarika, Utkantita, Vyasaksaja, Vipralabdha, Kandita, Kalahantarita, Prasita Bhatrika, Swadin Bhatrika. In this way, Rupa Goswami has described 360 different types of heroines. Rupa Goswami, with beautiful examples. So here he is saying, all of the different moods of the different heroines, they all come in you and manifest one after another, and it causes everyone to be struck with wonder, especially Krishna. All the attributes of a heroine, such as sweetness, attend your lotus feet, and even Lakshmi Devi prays for that beauty which is emanating from your toenails. You are the crest jewel and the flower bud of all the young gopis of Gokul. And your gentle smile is the life-giving tonic for all the sakis headed by Lalita. This is another quality of Radhika, that she is always the first under the control, she's controlled by her sakis. And that she is their life and soul. The sidelong glance from your restless eyes are like drops of nectar that make Krishna become mad. And you are the moon that expands the flower of your father's fame. So another quality of Radharani is that she's most respectful to her Gurujan. So here Rupa Goswami, in this poetry, is introducing all the various qualities of Radhika, how she relates with her father, Bishop Balu Maharaj and Mother Kirtida, with her seniors like Purnamasi and Madhu Yashoda. Apara Karunapura, your heart is like a fathomless reservoir, overflowing with compassion. This is another quality of Radhika. Karuna Purna. Once she saw that the baby calf of Krishna was eating some grass and a straw poked his nose and blood was coming. And seeing this, she began to cry. And she took the calf in her lap and she tore her own skirt and used it as a bandage to wipe the blood from the nose of the calf and put some kumkum on it as well to make it heal. So she called Karuna Purna. Very easily her heart is melting with compassion. Even for a calf that's connected with Krishna. And because you are like a fathomless reservoir overflowing with compassion, therefore, O Devi, please be pleased with this fallen soul who is longing and longing to become your maidservant. So now, Rupa Goswami, he has done, he was chanting Harinam and he became completely absorbed in Nam. Then he began to chant about the form of Radhika. And then we have seen verses, he's meditating on the qualities. And now he's begging, oh, I am your maidservant, please be merciful to me. And now the poetry will move into the remembrance of Seva and Leela. So in this way, Tannama Rupa Charitari Sukirtananu Svityo Kramena Rasanama Nasinyojan. Rupa Goswami said, one should engage the tongue and mind in a sequence, gradually. This is Bhajan Chaturya. How to go deeply in Bhajan and realize something. Now he's telling, oh Radhika, you were very jealous. And you were angry with Krishna. But after a long time, that cunning person, the son of Nanda Maharaj, he came and he spoke very beautiful, flattering words to you. And finally, after not looking at him even, you look up and smile. Man is over in one of two ways. If a smile will come in the corner of Radhika's mouth, even just a little, means man has gone. Or if a tear will come in the eye. These are the signs that man has just ended and has become pranay. And she's ready to accept Krishna. So Rupa Goswami is saying, at that time when Krishna flatters you and your man has just ended, you become ecstatic and you begin to glance at him. When will I witness such emotions? Tvam sadhu madhavi pushpa madhavena kalavida prasadyamanam svipyantim vijayasyamyaham kada. Krishna is very skillful and very artistic. And he decorates you with madhavi flowers. And the touch of your hands causes you to break out your entire form in perspiration. Seeing this, when will I take a palm leaf and fan you? So after Radha and Krishna's pastimes together, then Krishna decorates Radhika's hair. At that time, she's a type of heroine called Swadina Bhatrika Kanta. Completely controlled Krishna. Krishna's like a shadow. He does anything she will ask for. Krishna goes outside and picks some madhavi flowers and comes to decorate her, and she looks at them and it looks like a bumblebee has already landed on these flowers. They're not suitable. Find flowers that haven't been tasted by a bumblebee. Krishna, oh, I'm sorry, and goes back outside. And then he's trying to pick the flowers that haven't been touched by a bumblebee. And he comes back and decorates Radhika's hair. And by the touch of Krishna's hands, Radhika is perspiring with the sattvic bath. And Rupa Goswami is praying, when will I take a fan then and cool? Kali Vistransino Vakra Kesha Vrindasya Sundari Sanskaraya Kada Devi Janam Meitam Nideksasi. O Devi, O Sundari, after your loving pastimes with Krishna, your hair is completely disheveled. That's called Shushtubhamyu Sarup. Whose hair, when her hair is untied from the veini for braid, it becomes a huge mass of curls. When will you order your surrendered maidservant to comb your hair and decorate your hair again. You will see why this is Chatu Pushpanjali. Very clever, very cunning. Because Rupa Goswami never asks anything for himself. He's asking to render a service at that time when Radhika's ecstasy is at the highest because of her beautiful exchange of love with Krishna. Kadabimboshti tambulam mayatava mukamumbati arpamana gadadisha suno alchityava. Oh, Bimboshti. Bimboshti is the name of Radhika. It means one whose lips are like bimbo fruits. When will that day come that I will make tambul and I will offer this to your lotus mouth? But Krishna wanted the tambul, but I didn't give to him, I gave to you instead. And then Krishna, he'll by force, by kissing you, he'll take the tambul from Radhika's mouth. Into it. When will I witness such loving pastimes? Brajaraj Kumara Vallabha Kula Simanta Mani Prasiddhamehi Parivara Ganasya Teyata Padavimena Dalisari. Oh Radhika, since you are the crown jewel of Krishna's beloved gopis, be pleased with me and very, very quickly. Consider me your own family member. So Rupa Goswami is praying here. This is Sauhard Abhilas. Not only to attain his Ishta Devi, not only to render a favorable service, but to have so Surya Bhav that you will accept me as if I am your own family member. So then Rupa Goswami finally said, Karanam Muhur Atei Param Tava Brindavana Chakravartini Apikeshi Ripujaya Bhavetsa Chatu Pratana Bhajanam Janaha. Oh Radhika, I am begging you again and again. You are Brindavana Chakravartini. You know, Chakravarti, Chakra means wheel, and Varti means turning. So Chakravarti means the axle, because a wheel rotates around its axle. So Radhika is Vrindavana Chakravartini. That means everything is happening in Vrindavan. Everything is rotating all around Krishna. But Krishna is rotating around Radhika. So Radhika is Vrindavana Chakravartini. I am asking you for this benediction. Apikeshi ripuyor yaya bhavetsa chatu pratana bhajanam jana. May I become the recipient of the chatu pushpanjali of your beloved Krishna. What does it mean? The internal meaning here is that if Radharani is upset and refuses to meet with Krishna, then what can Krishna do? His only recourse is to go to any maidservant of Radharani and beg her to arrange somehow or other that he can go and meet with her. So just as Rupa Goswami has prayed, Nava Gauru Chana Gauri to Radhika, he's saying at the end, oh, when will give me the blessing that Krishna will have to come to me and say, Nava Gauru Chana Guru. Oh maiden, your complexion is so beautiful, your eyes are so restless, your hair is so beautiful. Please, take me to your Swami. Krishna will have to speak so many flattering words to persuade me to accept him and bring him to you. So this is a very beautiful benediction. If Radhika will hear this, oh, you want the benediction that Krishna is unable to meet with me without taking permission first from one of my smallest young maidservants? Radharani's tatastu. Sounds good. That's very nice. Why? Because if there are obstacles to meeting Krishna and you have to respect even her maidservants, then This will Krishna's anurag will be increased by the delays and the problems along the way of meeting with Radha. So finally, Rupa Goswami gives a benediction. Imam Vrindavaneshvarya janavya patatistavam chatu pushpanjalim nama sasya dasya vipaspadam. A fortunate soul who faithfully recites this chatu pushpanjali in glorification of Srimati Radhika will very quickly become the recipient of her mercy. So in this way, our Srila Rupa Goswami has described what bhakti is, how to practice it in the stage of sadhana, and then how one comes to bhava and pray. He's described all the various rasas, and especially Madhurya rasa, and the glories of Radhika. And he's also given the poetry that we can take shelter of. Rupa Anuga means to follow Rupa Goswami. To not imagine to concoct or create a path ourselves, because it will not be successful, but to precisely follow the method of bhajan he has manifested, so that we can gradually become in the stage of dhruva anusmriti, continuous remembrance, and then tishtan brajai tadanuragi tananugami, render services to the divine couple in their nitya lila. Gaura Premananda. Srila Rupa Goswami Pada Ki.